God is with me. God is for me. God has gifted me. And God will use me. God, help me to see that I'm a missionary.
Send someone across my path today who needs to hear about Jesus. Grant me courage and compassion to be your witness. Amen.
What is up, Journey fam? It is good to be here. As you already heard, if you didn't know, my name is Curtis. I'm the lead pastor of the Journey Metro East. But it's a blessing always to get to know our Journey fam from other churches. Let's start with a word of prayer before we open God's word. Lord God, we are overwhelmed by your grace and your mercy. We recognize that man, without you, Lord God, we are lost. We are orphans. We are wicked. We are sinners. We are evil. But Lord God, it's by the power of your Spirit that you have overcome our dark hearts and you've called us into the beautiful grace of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I pray, Lord God, that it's in this moment that you would overwhelm us, that you would be present. I pray for your Spirit to speak, God. Would you encourage, would you challenge, would you convict? Do a work in all of us, God. Lord, you know the needs, the cries, the issues of the heart of your people sitting in these seats. And I pray that you would move me to the side, and would you speak, and would you move and be glorified. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. So we've been looking in the book of Acts, and it's really the story of the movement and the growth of the church. Like, beginning to answer the question, how did this thing, the gospel, go from Jesus Christ, right, who died, buried, resurrected, ascended to heaven? How did it make it from him all the way to 2015 and to the heart of this 37-year-old black man named Curtis? Like, how did this happen? Or put yourself at the end of your Christian, how did it make it out of that? And Jesus really starts in the first chapter of Acts laying out the theme of Acts and really the vision of the church that we are called to be a church filled with witnesses that are taking this gospel to the ends of the earth. And so let's read Acts chapter 1 verse 8 together, because all that we talk about really is under this banner and has this as the goal of all things. So let's read together. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. And then after Jesus ascends, he sends them. He says, hey, go, all right? And I'm going to send the Holy Spirit who will fill you. And in chapter 2, that filling came, that the Spirit powerfully moved, right? And powerfully moved, and we saw its power because Peter, all right? Peter, who was once a coward, stands up and preaches this beastly sermon, and many are saved as a result. And the church, not a church, but the church is birthed, out of which every other church has come about. And so where we find ourselves in Acts 3 and 4 is the continuation of this movement, all right? This narrative of the gospel resting on Jesus Christ, moving through his people towards the end of the earth. And so where we find ourselves in chapter 3, we see Peter and John, who the Spirit had filled them, and now they're going towards the temple to pray, doing their Christian duty. On their way to the temple, they walk by a lame beggar who is sitting there begging for change. And imagine walking down the streets downtown, an injured vet standing there asking for change. It's that kind of situation. And then Peter walks by, and as he's begging for change, Peter looks at him, and he says, hey, look at me. And he says, I don't have money for you, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise and walk. And then this lame man, mind you, this lame man who's been lame from the moment of his birth, who had been laid there at the gate, the beautiful gate, on a daily basis to beg for change. This lame man who is over 40 years old. Now this lame man who had he's only been known to be a lame man, who's only been known to be a beggar. Now he's up walking, and not just walking. Verse 8 in chapter 3 says that he is leaping with joy, rejoicing of the miraculous power of Jesus Christ. And he leaps. Now the same thing happened then that would happen here. If a man that was lame in a wheelchair, and all we've known him as to be a lame man, all of a sudden in the middle of the sermon, he gets up and starts running around, we all gonna pay attention, right? You're gonna start ignoring me and watching him, right? That is what happened. They were astounded and moved towards what's going on. And Peter does what he does. He takes advantage of the moment and he preaches the gospel. Now, I love Peter, all right, because Peter, we've always known Peter is just an open, honest, raw dude. And the Spirit has moved on him, but that hasn't been lost, because he preaches this honest gospel where he doesn't water it down, he doesn't soften it, right? He preaches the gospel and says, hey, Jesus Christ, he came to you, you murdered him, now you need to say you're sorry, right? Like, that's what he says. He says, you're the murderers. You're the reason why he went to the cross. Now, you need to repent for what he did. And through that repentance, he says, there will be times of refreshing. That's the invitation of the gospel, that as we face the reality that we are wicked sinners and we repent and turn from our wicked ways, there are times of refreshing and joy on the other side of that. And so Peter preaches. And then we get to the response to this miracle, the response to the preaching of the gospel. And this is what Luke really wants us to pay attention to in the fourth chapter, is these two drastically different responses to the gospel. Like, on one end, there's a group of people who are greatly annoyed by this. And on the other end, there's a group of people who joyfully surrender to this. And so Luke wants us to wrestle with these responses. Luke wants us to wrestle where we're at with these responses. And then as the church, as Christians, Luke wants us to respond to wrestle with how we respond to the deeply annoyed ones of the gospel. And so we see in the chapter of 4, where the first four verses. Now we got to pay attention. And Luke is very intentional with his words, very intentional with the order that he lays things, because he wants you to know the context of when things are happening and why they're happening. So let's read the first four verses of Acts 4. It says, and as they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, greatly annoyed, because they were teaching and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But verse 4, right? But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. Luke wants us to land the fact that, hey, Peter preaches this, and there is a group. And when it says deeply annoyed, that word annoyed, it's not like, oh, I'm annoyed by this gnat that's flying around my face. No, it's I am grieved. I am angered. I am deeply bothered by what you're talking about, Peter and John. So much so that they came and lay hands upon them, not in a gospel way, but lay hands upon them, cuff them, right, and drag them off. It's when that happens, many people come to believe. Like, imagine officers busting here. I'm taking you away. They rush the stage. They lay hands upon me, drag me off, and then I yell out, here's the gospel. Do you want it? Right? And now most of y'all are going to be like, I don't know him. Send him back to Metro East. Right? Like y'all going to deny that y'all know me. Right? But what Luke is getting the point across is the Holy Spirit, the gospel is so powerful that even when that's happening, there will be some that rise up and say, hey, I want that. Hey, I'll get arrested. I don't mind. Like, that's the beauty and the power of the gospel, to overcome the evil heart and pull that evil heart into the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Luke does not want us to miss that reality. And so they are arrested, Peter and John. All right. And then they spend the night in jail. And then Peter then stands before the council. And now Luke's in the Luke chapter verses 5 through 12, he lays out really the reality of who this council is that Peter is talking to. All right, he says, "Look, these are scribes, these are elders. This is a high priestly family." He gives us the specific names of the family, and what he wanted to get across is that these are not just some raggedy dudes. This is varsity level opposition. Like, if there's any crew of dudes that has the power to stop the movement, remember Acts 1:8, the movement of being witnesses from Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. If there's a crew that had the ability and the power to stop it, it would be this crew. And so Luke, writing to Theophilus, wants Theophilus to even pause and wonder, oh snap, what's going to happen? Is it going to make it, right? And that's really what he wants us to wrestle with. What does it look like when the gospel and Christians in the church come up against opposition? Which one wins in the end? And so this is varsity level opposition and standing in front of these freshman B team level dudes. And Peter continues to do what he does, and he preaches the word of God. And we see that this preaching towards the council is met with deep opposition. And so we see these responses: belief in the gospel and unbelief to the gospel. We see there's this surrendering to the gospel and there's a opposing the gospel. Which side are you? And then Christians, how do we engage those who are opposing us? And Luke wants us to understand the nature of unbelief, the nature of opposition, so that we're not confused and think this is just a matter of differing of opinions or differing of ideas when we share the gospel. That there's something much more complex happening when those who don't believe, happening when those who oppose the gospel. And we see that in verses 13 through 17 in chapter 4. It says, "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished. And they recognized that they had been with Jesus." Now listen, now here's the council. They're standing in front of the council. "But seeing the man who was healed standing beside them," here's Peter and John. And off to the side, it's this dude who's now walking, right? He's shaking his head. "Look at my legs. I can walk now," right? There is no confusion on the power because the miracle is standing in front of them. Luke wants us to pay attention to the reality of there are facts standing in front of them. But let's see how they respond to these facts. "But seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. But when they had commanded them to leave the council, they conferred with one another, saying," here, listen, "what shall we do with these men? For that a notable sign has been performed through them is evident to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and we can't even deny it. But in order that it may spread no further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name." Here we have really the nature of unbelief, that oftentimes you will hear this argument: well, Christianity doesn't make sense, and if you just presented the facts, I would believe. Luke is telling us actually there's much more going on in the hardness of heart than just an exchange of facts, an exchange of beliefs, and that the reality is at the core of unbelief, at the core of opposition, it's not an issue of facts. Luke is saying, if the facts stood up, smacked you in the face, sat down and said, "I'm here," the chances are you will still not believe, because the hardness of heart is deep, and there's more of a spiritual component to it, and there's more of a wrestling of control. It's not just a mental exchange of facts that if you knew these facts, you would still believe. Luke is showing us that's actually not true. What's going on with them and what goes on when we're sharing the gospel with people and they're wrestling through and they say, I would believe if you approve it. And I have friends like that. I'm in a conversation with one friend who is working hard not to believe. I mean, we have conversation every time we satisfy one issue, he'll work hard to create other issues. Why such an emotional response? Why were they greatly annoyed? Why are people greatly annoyed? Why? Because it's not an issue of facts, it's an issue of control. At the heart of the human heart, the base of the human heart, we do not want to give up control. We do not want to say somebody else gets to run my life. We like control. And no, even when we're messing our lives up, we will fight hard to maintain it. The religious leaders are working hard to maintain the control of the situation, the control of their lives, the control of how the people viewed them, the control of how they viewed themselves. And they're working hard to control that. No human being wakes up wanting to give up control. No human being wakes up singing, "Jesus, take the wheel." Jesus, don't touch my steering wheel, right? Get in the back seat. In fact, I'm dropping you off at 4th Street. You know, get out the car, right? That is the heart of a human heart. That is what we're always having to wrestle with. And it doesn't go away. Even with us Christians, we have to surrender that to the Lord Jesus Christ on a daily basis. Because every day we would love to take back control of things. And at the core of unbelief, it's this unwillingness to relinquish control. We do not want it, and we will work hard to keep control. And so we see with the religious leaders, they are fighting hard to control a few things. One, they're fighting hard to control the power and the influence that they have. They understand that if this thing proves to be true, they will no longer be the powerful ones. And these people were willing to do anything. The Sadducees, like one scholar would say, they're so willing to maintain control, they would have sold their mother, right? Like that is how control hungry they are. And really, how control hungry we are. We will fight hard. We will turn away from what things that do make sense. Even if we're ruining our lives, we will fight hard to live under the facade of it. Because hear me, it wasn't about truth for them. They would rather benefit from the lie than the joy of the truth. Because at least in the lie, they could maintain control. They could remain powerful and they could remain influential. It's complete turning away from truth and maintaining control. And they wanted to control the power and the influence of their lives. Because hear me, like many of us, we don't like the idea of not being the one in charge. It's a scary thought. The idea that when Jesus steps on the scene and he will demand me to lay everything down, to lay my career down, to lay my identity down, to lay my status down, to lay my family down, and I don't get to run that anymore, that is a scary thought. I would rather stay within the grips of the enemy, devil himself. That's unbelievable. If you are here and you're not trusting in the Lord, here's what the reality is. You are choosing to remain enslaved to the enemy, who only has harm as a desire for you, because you're too scared to turn away and find that on the other side of repentance, there's joy and refreshing. You are choosing. It's like an abuse victim, never able to see themselves outside of abuse, so they will willingly stay within the abuse because they can't see themselves as other than an abuse victim. It's too scary of a thought. They'd rather stay comfortable in a dangerous, harmful, hurtful situation. And that is the human heart. That's unbelief. That to give control up, I'd rather live under the lie and the facade of control. I'd rather stay in the grips of the enemy than say I have to lay this thing down to give control over to Jesus Christ. And Luke says, this is what we want to pay attention to. And that's why Peter comes against that. He comes against that in a variety of ways. But one, he preaches the exclusivity of Jesus Christ, right? Like in verse 12, he says, here's Jesus is no joke. When it comes to salvation, there is no other name but Jesus through which salvation can be found. This is why exclusivity is offensive to the leaders and offensive to us. Because we want power and influence. Exclusivity tells us that anything you bring to the table doesn't count anymore. I don't care how good you are. I don't care how good you smell. I don't care what family you are from. Whatever you bring to the table, it doesn't matter anymore. Move that off the table. The only thing that stands on the table is Jesus Christ and himself alone. And that's the gospel. And that's the exclusivity of it that Peter's saying. There is no good works. There is no sincerity that brings you in. This was offensive to the leaders. This is offensive to us. Hear me, not just unbelievers. We live in a time where there are many Christians who say, well, I embrace the gospel for me. But you know what? So-and-so, I mean, they're sincere. They're good people. So what? So what? They're Muslim. So what? Hear me. That's a big so what? You have just minimized Jesus Christ. Like, the moment you add good works and sincerity to the equation of salvation, you have ripped away the power of the gospel. You have not improved the gospel, and you have not been any more loving. In fact, you have just looked Jesus in the face and told him your death and burial and resurrection doesn't matter, because for other people, as long as they're good, it's okay with Jesus. No, Jesus died for a reason. We are wicked sinners. We need a salvation outside of ourselves, somebody to come step out of heaven onto earth to die on the cross, resurrect, securing our salvation forever. Good works and sincerity doesn't matter. And Christian, we must stand on that. We must boldly stand on that. And I know that sounds, I know that can sound arrogant. I hear friends will say, man, that's arrogant for you to say that. Hear me, it's not arrogant. We're not arrogant, we're just sure about something. We're sure that Jesus really is who he says he is. We don't place ourselves as better than anyone else. We're the first ones to admit we are wicked, rebellious sinners. I'm a raggedy dude. I know who I am. I know who I am. I'm not arrogant. I'm just sure that Jesus is who he says he is. I see, as Lewis says, either he's a liar, a lunatic, or Lord. Because, and hear me, we would rather act like he's a liar or a lunatic, because the moment we say he's Lord, that means he demands some things from us. But he is Lord, and we are sure of that. Therefore, we joyfully surrender what he demands. We are not arrogant. In fact, the exclusivity of Jesus Christ is the most gracious, inclusive thing there is. Here's why. I love Tim Keller calls it the most inclusive exclusivity that there is, because it is exclusively through Jesus Christ and him alone. But that invitation goes to every human being, every man, woman, boy, girl, every color, every shade, every shape. Whether you pretty, whether you ugly, it's the invitation for you. Now, I ain't calling nobody ugly. I'm just saying. There is not a person that this invitation is not for. It's the most grace-filled, inclusive invitation that there is. All come, all find fresh refreshing, all find rest, all come. But hear me, come through Jesus Christ and him alone, and him alone. And so they did not want that, because that came against their power. The moment we say it's only Jesus, that means all that you've been building on doesn't matter. And that the control of authority, they don't want to give that up either. Like Peter talks about, we see in verse 11, this Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. Everyone say cornerstone? When he says the cornerstone, he is coming against the authority in which they place themselves under. He is saying, see, the cornerstone is the keystone of a building, right? Back in those days, a builder would spend as much time finding and shaping this cornerstone as he was building the whole building, because everything depended on this cornerstone. Everything rested on this cornerstone. Everything found its definition and meaning and significance on this cornerstone. So if you want a nice house, you need a nice cornerstone. If you want a raggedy house, you stick with a raggedy cornerstone. Everything depended on the cornerstone. And when Peter steps in and says, this stone, which whom you rejected, is the cornerstone of your life and of the universe. What he's saying is, everything else you have rested upon, every other authority you've submitted yourself to, does not count anymore. Jesus is the only cornerstone for which you should build your life. Jesus is the only authority to which you should submit to. He says, if you place the eternal weight of the purpose of your life, the satisfaction and fulfillment of your soul, on anything else besides the cornerstone, hear me, that cornerstone is inadequate and it will disappoint you. It will disappoint you. Here's why they're so offended by Peter. He's coming against their control. He's coming against their life system. He's coming against the very reason that they live. He's coming against the cornerstone that they built them. But this is a gracious thing for Peter to say, your cornerstone doesn't work. For us to lay our lives on anything outside of Jesus, your career, your status, your money, your family, your spouse, your future spouse, your kids, whatever it is, if you laid any anything eternal on that, you will smash it, and it doesn't have the strength to hold it. It's like placing the weight of an elephant on a fly. Now, I don't care how many bench presses that fly does or how much CrossFit that fly does, you will never root that fly on and think it's going to actually hold the elephant. You place that elephant on that fly, it's a bad day for the fly, no matter what. No matter what, he is destined for failure because he was never made to hold such weight. Neither is your spouse, neither is your career, neither is your future, neither is your status, neither anything else other than Jesus. Jesus Christ and him alone has the eternal strength, the muscles to hold up the eternal weight of the universe, of the purpose of your life, and the satisfaction of your soul. Jesus and him alone. And Peter is saying, he is the cornerstone. For if you rest on anything else, you will be disappointed. So Peter is challenging these areas. And they says, okay, that's enough. In fact, their response, you would think, all of this is when the gospel is preached and the truth is thrown out there, it's an invitation to blessing and joy and refreshment. It comes through facing the truth, though. So here's how things are going to be different, right? There are different responses. And we're going to see that despite the facts that are standing in front of them, despite that the miracle is standing in front of them, despite all that, despite Peter is inviting them in to the beautiful grace of Jesus, despite all that, they say no. So much so, they say, we see all that you're talking about, but we would rather maintain control. We would rather stay in unbelief. We would rather for this not to spread anymore. Here's a key of unbelief. Like you see real quick, they don't just want to believe it want to stay in unbelief for themselves. They would rather this message not preach to anybody else. That's the one thing about unbelief. Like you want everybody else to join in with you. It's just same with the religious leaders. They say, nah, we're going to stay here and we want to make sure nobody else hears this good news either. And so here's Peter and John. And the question is, how will they respond to such opposition? How will they respond? Well, we see belief opposed, belief in the gospel opposed. Now let's see it displayed in the face of opposition. And so what we see really quick in verse 4, we see, and really in the book of Acts, we see Luke making one thing clear. There's a lot of ways that belief in the gospel is displayed for all to see and displayed against opposition. But one of the key ways that Luke is wanting to get across, one of the ways that belief is displayed is through our mouths. It's through speaking. Like much of Acts is centered on sermons, speeches, and conversations. Much of it is centered on the preaching of the gospel. Much of it is centered on the hearing of the gospel. Much of it. And what Luke is getting across is showing us we are not part of a quiet faith. We are part of a speaking faith. Our faith is moved and it grows through us opening our mouth and speaking. Every Christian, every church should be a speaking church. Not just from me who's a preacher, but from every human being who says, I have allegiance with Jesus Christ, I find myself under the blood of Jesus Christ, and I have the identity of Jesus Christ. If that is you, it is on your job description to open your mouth and speak the gospel. It's on your job description to open your mouth and speak for those who are marginalized. It's on your job description to be an encouragement to those around you. That is on your job description as a believer in Jesus Christ. We do not have a quiet faith, especially in the time where we live in, where there's a lot of hostility. And we're tempted to scale back. This is why Acts 3 and 4 is so relevant to us. We're living in a time very similar to that, where much opposition, many faiths are arguing over, well, is Jesus really the only way? Can we add more to it? Much of that is happening, that was happening there, is happening for us. The question is, will we speak like Peter and John? Will we speak boldly? And will we speak with authority? And we see that Peter and John, they spoke boldly. That's one thing, way we see belief displayed, speaking boldly, speaking with the courage that Peter and John had. And they spoke boldly. Here's why. One reason, because here come the cops, come to get me. Now here. Spoke boldly Because first, because of the historical objective facts of Christianity. The root of his boldness wasn't in himself. The root of his boldness was in the fact that this was true, whether someone agreed with it or not, or they liked it or not, it's true. Your Christianity, our Christianity, is built on objective historical facts. When we talk about Christianity, we're not talking about philosophical ideas that could be compared to other philosophical ideas. No, we're talking about a faith that is rooted on historical facts of somebody really coming from heaven and being born, really living life, really dying on the cross and being buried, and really resurrecting. When Peter stands up with boldness, what he's saying is, hey man, I've seen the dude. I've seen him die. I've seen him come back. I can't but speak of what I've seen and heard. And so that gives me the confidence, not because I'm looking for you to like me, because I can't deny what I've seen. This is the Christian faith. Here's why we can have boldness and confidence. This is not just the comparison of ideas. This is something that really did happen. Our faith is built upon that. We submit to that because Jesus really was who he said he was, and he really believed that. We really believe that. It is built on historical fact, but not just historical fact that gives us boldness. Another reason why we can have boldness is because our lives have been transformed by this fact. Now look at Peter and John. Peter, like the fact that Peter is in the middle of the store speaking such bold words, it's crazy. Like, everyone should pause, like, is this the same Peter? Like, the same Peter that not that long ago, and we're talking about just a matter of weeks ago, right? That he miserably failed Jesus Christ. He miserably, look, he got punked out by a servant girl, ended up cussing a little girl out. He stood in front of Jesus' face. Jesus said, hey man, you're gonna deny me. And Peter says, nah, dude, I got you to the day you die. Well, what happened? Peter denied him 3 times, ran off. This same Peter, who was once an overwhelming failure, a fierce coward, is now standing there with his shoulders up, his head up, and saying, this is the Jesus and to whom you must repent. Jesus has been transformed by this gospel. It's not just built on historical fact, but the reality is this faith changes things. Look at the lame man. It changes things. This lame man who's been lame for over 40 years is now walking. Look at me, Peter says. It changes. I was once a coward. Now I'm strong. Look at me. I am a walking example. We can be bold because the gospel really does change things. Have you been changed by Jesus Christ? If you have been changed by Jesus Christ, you must open your mouth and share that. Who cares if you don't know the complexities of every theological issue that there is? You have one thing, your story. If you know Jesus Christ in any sense of the word, open your mouth and share that. I don't care what your story. I don't care if you got saved when you were 4 years old. You were a heathen at 3. Tell them how you used to smack girls when you're 3 years old. Jesus saved me when I was 4. I was a heathen child. Look, tell them that. And now I am a new person. Tell them that. Because the power of the gospel is in a transformed life. You can share that. I stand here speaking to you with boldness, not because I'm anything, but because I was dark and wicked and cold and hard-hearted, but God rescued me from myself. And now I can stand here and say, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. Look at me. I am a walking example of the reality of historical fact, and it's saying, if this is true, you must submit to it. Christian church, we can be bold. If you have a story anyway, you can be bold in sharing it. And not just speak with boldness, but speak with authority. The authority that's rooted in the Spirit of God. These guys, it calls them common and uneducated men. What Luke is trying to get across is, hey man, Peter and John, again, remember what I said? They're not, like, we know them as the apostles. They knew them as raggedy dudes. So Peter and John, in front of the council, the council, the dudes that could shut everything down, is sitting there speaking with authority. And it's telling them, they're common and uneducated. What Luke is getting across is they are speaking on matters that usually rabbis who have deep and long rabbinical education can only speak about. But these dudes who have no education is now speaking as though they know something. In fact, not that they don't call them just common and uneducated, but it says, it seems like they've been with Jesus, because this council remembers there once was a man who actually sounded very similar to them, and they said this is the exact same thing. Who is this man that speaks with such authority, who has not flowed through the systems that we've set up to really keep you qualified to speak? Here's Peter and John, the raggedy dudes, speaking with such authority. You know why? Because it's rooted not in themselves, but in the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God gives them all the authority to speak. The relationship with Jesus Christ gives them all authority to speak. We are common, uneducated people. I don't care what degrees you have or don't have. Like, I am a common, uneducated man. Like, I love the fact. Now, I love education, by the way. But I've never been to seminary. Hope to go one day, but never been. I absolutely love it. Here's why. Because I love to see people's face when they ask me what seminary I went to, right? So I'll get done from preaching, I'll come down, they're excited. Man, what seminary you went to? Man, I ain't got no seminary. I mean, I like to read, I got books, right? Does that count? I'm like, I've never been to seminary. Man, I love their face. They don't know what to do. They're like, okay, right? Like, because they don't, it's like, okay, why are you speaking like that, but you haven't gone through this? Now, I'm not anti-education, so please hear that. And I love seminaries. But the reality is, I love the fact that the only thing that you can point to when it comes to Curtis Gilbert is the Spirit of God. I am common, I am uneducated, and the only boldness and confidence that you see is the Spirit of God. And whatever you hear that sounds like it's making sense, it ain't me. I'm a plumb fool. But it's Jesus Christ filling me and speaking through me. Now hear me. And so are you. You are common and uneducated, and your authority is not in what you have and don't have. The authority is in the Spirit of God, so speak. So our response as a church, four responses. What does it mean for us today? What does it mean for us as we're facing very similar opposition? What does it mean for us when we are sharing the gospel with family and friends and they push it back? What does it mean when we're feeling overwhelmed by the moment? Like, surely somewhere in back of Peter and John's thinking, they're thinking, man, the church just was birthed. Why we gotta face this already? Like, surely, right? So how do we respond to opposition? And how do we continue this movement going? Not just from Acts, but now in 2015, 2016, 2017. And so four things. We believe. We believe the gospel. If you are a non-Christian here, one, we're so glad you are here. I want to just gently encourage you and challenge you. Would you believe? Would you trust Jesus today? Like, you are working hard to push away the very refreshment that you are longing for. Like, come to him. You are choosing to stay within the grips of the enemy. Come to him. Like, why would you stiff-arm the very Savior of the universe who so longs to give you all that you are looking for in other ways? Come to him if you don't know him. Wrestle with the truth. As much energy as you're putting into proving him wrong, why don't you put that energy in wrestling with the truths of the matter? Christian, believe. We must keep believing the gospel. We never move from the gospel, Christians. The same gospel, the same grace that we stand on for initial faith is what we stand on for sustaining faith. The same gospel and grace that we rest in from now until glory. You never stand on your good works. You never stand on that you're killing it for Jesus. Whether you have a good day, a bad day, whether you are reading, you've been in your Bible reading plan every day since January 1, or you are missing days, in fact, weeks, and you can't get it. No matter where you are, the grace of Jesus Christ covers you. And that's within which we stand. It's under the blood of Jesus Christ that we stand. And when God looks upon us, he sees the identity of Jesus Christ through us. So hear me. We must keep believing and standing on the gospel and not shying away from that. Our boldness comes from the fact that the gospel stays real to us on a daily basis. Keep preaching the gospel to yourself. If your heart is dull and dead to the gospel, start preaching it to yourself. Start singing about the gospel. But believe the gospel. Our hearts should cry out, cast your deadly doing down at Jesus' feet. Stand in him and him alone, gloriously complete. That is the cry of the Christian. Secondly, we must risk. We believe and we risk. Peter and John, they boldly stepped into risky situations. The church boldly stepped into risky situations. They did not shy away. They weren't overly worried about being liked. Now, I understand that pressure. Like, we all want to be liked, do we not? We don't wake up wanting to be marginalized. I know some people wake up, I love when people don't like me. Don't worry, they don't, right? Like, I got a friend that glories in not being liked. He just likes it, right? But most of us, we want to be liked. There's nothing wrong with that. What's wrong with that is when we exalt that over proclaiming the glory of Jesus Christ. What ought to always stay on top is the glory of Jesus Christ. And our being liked has to stay under that. We're living in a time where the moment you speak up, the moment you sound different, you're going to look like a fool. You're going to sound like a fool. They're going to call you a fool. You're going to be marginalized. Some people will not want to hang with you. So the challenge is, will you choose to stay in that position, or will you exalt being liking over the glory of Jesus Christ? And hear me, we all fail at this, all right? So there's nobody in here killing it in that area. We'll have moments where we should speak. We'll have moments where we should step in. We'll have moments where we should proclaim something, and we don't. So we must surrender ourselves to the Spirit of God and let him birth boldness out of us, in us, so that we stand bold and we risk. Here's a beautiful thing about risking. We get more of God when we risk. Like, the Spirit of God filled Peter and he spoke. The Spirit of God later in chapter 4 filled the church and they spoke. There's a direct connection between the filling of the Spirit and them doing something. I got people crying out for more of God, but you're not doing nothing. He ain't giving you his Spirit so you can sit on the couch eating some Doritos. Do something. Like, he feels so you can speak. He feels so you can do. He feels so you can risk. He feels that. So if you're not experiencing God, here's a quick way to experience God. And I promise you, share the gospel with somebody. Even when you're rejected, I can tell you on a consistent basis, when I share the gospel, even when people reject me, there's a greater sense of God's presence, a greater sense of God's anointing in that moment, no matter what. Look, Phil, you want more of God? Share the gospel. Speak for the marginalized. Step into people's life. Give your life over to others. You will experience more of God. We must risk. We must risk. Third, we must pray. After they left the council, Peter and John went to the church. And you're wondering, man, what's going to happen? Are they going to pray? They're going to pray that the council be thrashed down, right? Like, that's something I would pray. Lord, shut it down. Lord, destroy them. I want rocks to fall out the sky and hit them in the head. Like, Lord, destroy the council, right? Does the church pray that? No. Lord, pray. We pray for boldness. Boldness to pour upon us as we're facing this threat. And we pray that your hand extends for healing and miracles so that all would know the beauty of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We should pray, Christian. We should pray, church, that we would steward our moment in history well. We all will one day be in the grave. Our greatest prayer is, Lord, help us to steward our moment in history well so that when we hand the baton of the kingdom of God over to the next generation, we can do so with confidence, we can do so with honor, because we boldly stepped into it, we boldly gave, and we boldly prayed to steward our moment well. That's what we should be praying for. And then lastly, we should be living countercultural lives. Lives that really rocked the world. The church was a drastically generous church back then. And Luke wants us to see, the fact of the matter is, when the gospel grips your heart, it opens your hands. And we see in such a way, it says about them, there was not a needy person among them. It says in chapter 4, read it. Not a needy person among them. They lived with such generosity that they ended poverty in their hood. They said, because the gospel is so rich and so beautiful, I don't care what I own. I don't care. I just want the better for you. I want more for you. The gospel opens your hands for greater generosity and opens your life for greater service. The church was known to serve the broken, to serve the helpless, to serve the dead, the dirty. Like when plagues would hit areas, when people would run, Christians would run into the plagues. They did not mind dying as long as others were saved. That is the Christian church. The Christian church runs into serving others. We should be known for loving and walking with the messy of the messy. We should be known for walking with those where the religious people would say, why are you doing that? We should be known walking with that man who's struggling with homosexuality. We should be known for walking with that woman who is struggling with depression and mental illness and suicide, sitting with her all night long and speaking truth to her. We should be known walking with that single mom who's raising three kids. We should be known walking with that teenager who's angry because he doesn't have a dad and he doesn't know what to do with that anger, so he keeps getting kicked out of school and going to jail. We should be walking with these people. That is what the church is about. That's how we push back opposition. That's how we remain to be the church for years to come. So church, let's rise up and be this. Let the Spirit of God fill us so that we can speak with boldness and speak with authority. And so that we can believe the gospel. We can step in a risky situation. We can pray for God to be glorified through our lives. And we can live such lives that when others look at us, they have nothing to argue against. They may not like our Jesus, but they can't argue against our lives. May we live examples of the beautiful gospel of Jesus Christ. And through that, may we push opposition back and see the kingdom of God pushed well beyond our lifetime. Let's pray. Lord God, we pray that you are glorified in us and through us. And pray that we really do rise and be the church. Not in our power, God, but in the Spirit. This is not being confident in our ability to be bold, but this is resting in the gospel that makes us bold. And for all of us who fail at this, we pray, we repent, and we pray that you would fill us and transform us. Do a deep work in us and through us, and be glorified. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.